Good afternoon, and welcome to Grace Cathedral's virtual organ recital. My name is Christopher Keady. I'm the Assistant Director of Music here at Grace Cathedral, and I'm so grateful that you're able to join us online today. We wish you were here in person and look forward to that in the future. I'm very excited also to introduce our first guest organ recitalist since the pandemic began, Robert Hugh Morgan. He's a local colleague and university organist at Stanford in the south of the Bay Area. You can read more about him on the program listing accompanying the video that you're watching. Our organ recital series depends on your donations for its continued success. So as much as you're able, we appreciate your generosity. There should be links to donate nearby, whether you're on Facebook or on our website. And so thank you again for your support, and I hope you enjoy the recital. Now let me welcome Robert Hugh Morgan.
Good afternoon, everybody, and welcome. Thank you for tuning in for this concert. And to start off, I must say thanks so much to the wonderful Christopher Keady for inviting me here to play this recital for you this afternoon on a very, I must say, dark, wet afternoon in San Francisco. But thank you again, Chris, and also thanks to Ben Bachman, of course, the director of music here. The recitals that I usually play usually have a theme running through them. This one doesn't. It's fun music. It's music I enjoy playing, and I hope it's music that you'll enjoy listening to. So you just heard that wonderful march by Prokofiev, transcribed for organ by Jean Guillou. Now we're going to move on to another very short piece. This piece is called The Cloister-Garth by Herbert Brewer. Brewer was a native of the city of Gloucester in England and later became director of music at Gloucester Cathedral, a position that he held for many years. And this little piece again, it's just a little 2-3 minute piece, is a little musical picture of the pretty, pretty little cloister garden, the little area right in the middle of the cloister at Gloucester Cathedral. It's a very simple piece of music, but I think it's an absolute gem. Following that, we go on to another picture. This time, the Clair de Lune of Louis Vierne. Last year, in 2020, we were, in common with many other places, celebrating the 150th anniversary of the birth of Louis Vierne, but of course that all came to a crashing halt. We were performing all six of his symphonies. We made it as far as number four. So I thought it'd be nice to carry on and just give another nudge towards Louis Vierne, even in 2021. So this piece is just a gorgeous picture of moonlight on a landscape. And it's got a melody at the beginning. Firstly, the melody starts really high in the right hand. Very, very, very high, and stays up there. It comes down and goes back up. And also, at times, it's just kind of bluesy in its affect as well. But I think, you know, as this picture of this landscape, it's a work of great, great genius and great beauty. It's one of my favorite pieces. I remember once reading an article on art by the comedian and actor Steve Martin. And he tells the story of once he was at the Hermitage in St. Petersburg with a bunch of art historians. And one of these eminent art historians leant over to him and said, do you know what I love most about art? And Steve Martin thought that it was going to be some incredible thing about proportion and gesture. But the guy leaned over and said, it's when artists show moonlight reflecting on water. I think that's what makes art. And so, have a think about that while I'm playing this piece. So here's the Cloister-Garth by Herbert Brewer and the Clair de Lune by Louis Vierne. Thank you very much. What a fabulous piece, and I wish you could be here to hear it in this space with me. This room just sings with the sound of the organ in it. It really does. Now onto the main course. The Fantasia and Fugue on Ad Nos Ad Salutarem Undam by Franz Liszt. It is, I believe, the pinnacle of romantic organ music. The chorale on which this is based comes from an opera by the French-German composer Giacomo Meyerbeer. It's an opera called Le Prophète, The Prophet. And Liszt was a big fan of Meyerbeer and really gave a lot of support to any performances of his operas. Meyerbeer became very much the master of the Grand Opéra in Paris in the time of the early Romantic period. Now, the thing which I find wonderful about Liszt's Fantasia and Fugue is that we never get to hear Meyerbeer's original in its as it appears in the opera. When it appears in the opera, it's kind of lugubrious and slightly lilting at the same time. Ad nos ad salutarem undam. C minor, 6-4, lilts along nicely. Liszt sets his agenda right at the beginning of this piece. It's not lilting, it's far from gentle. It's agitato marcato, it is an angry beginning. It really is very, very, very big rhythmic figures, big rhythmic gestures. Liszt was a fan of, and also did an awful lot of work in designing pieces that were basically in one movement long. So, the other big example from Liszt is, of course, his sonata in B minor for piano. And also, as organists, we must never forget the sonata in C minor by Julius Reubke. Again, a single movement. Reubke studied with Liszt in Weimar. So Liszt presents us, it's called a Fantasia and Fugue, but let's say that it's in three movements, basically. The opening Fantasia, and then there is the gentle middle movement, which presents us with a set of variations, if you will, on this chorale. But it's as far from Meyerbeer's original as you can get. Now, it's not in C minor. It's not lilting. It's in F sharp major, which for Liszt was the mystical key. With all those lovely sharps in the key signature and the lovely colors that you get from it. And you hear the chorale on the quietest sound in the organ. And then he does this lovely set of variations, as I say. But then you get to the end of that subject and we come into the third movement, if you will, which begins with a big pedal cadenza and then launches us into the fugue. The fugue is far, far away from Meyerbeer's original. It's a strong, dotted figure. It's in 3-4. But it doesn't stay a fugue for long. By the time the fourth voice comes in, Liszt is straining at the leash. He wants to do something outside of that contrapuntal, shall we say, the square box of the counterpoint. And so Liszt then breaks into pretty much what we had in the first section in the Fantasia. And then at the end, we hear Meyerbeer's original, not in 6-4, not in C minor, not lugubrious at all, C major, 4-4, full organ, and on to the end we go. This is a remarkable piece. It's a piece that I like to revisit every few years because each time I play it, I find something new. It's incredibly inventive music. It really is. And as a performer, it inspires me to be picking up on all these new things. So here is Liszt's Fantasy and Fugue on Adnos et Salutarem Undam. And again, thank you to the people here at Grace Cathedral for the hospitality. Thanks to Chris Keady again for the very, very kind invitation. It's not often that I can play a recital at a place which is 10 minutes drive from home, but I'm happy to say that was the case today. So thank you again, Chris, for the invitation. And thank you all for listening.